He can move mountains. Keep me in the valley. Hide me from the rain.
Good morning, people. You're welcome again to Gateway to Life. I am Pastor Bridget Obgeifun, and I'm very excited to be with you again today. And I know that God has something new. And by the grace of God, we will be able to get that which God has for us this morning. But before we go further, let's just pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this glorious day that you have made, that will rejoice and be glad in. Father, I thank you, O God, because your word is quick, it is powerful, it is sharper than any two-edged sword. Thank you, O God, because your word brings clarity, O God. Even as we go into your word this morning, I ask, O God, for clarity, O God. I ask, O God, that every scales be falling from off the eyes of men and women that will be watching this morning in the name of Jesus. Lord, that at the end, the glory shall be given to you, and we would have been equipped with that which you want us to know. In Jesus' mighty name I've prayed. Amen. You're welcome again. It's Gateway to Life, and this morning we want to look at what I titled Spiritual Warfare. You know, in the church today, in Christendom generally, that's term is not an uncommon one. It's something you hear people talk about all the time. Spiritual warfare. We're going to war. We're going to battle. Many times it has become a cliche that we have lost the real meaning of what spiritual warfare is all about, or how we should indulge in spiritual warfare. So this morning, what I'll be doing, I'll be making an attempt to, you know, help us understand what spiritual warfare entails and how we should go about, practicing this particular spiritual warfare. And so I tried to come up with a definition, and I said spiritual warfare is resisting, overcoming, and defeating the enemy's lies in the form of deception, temptations, an accusation that is sent our way. He says spiritual warfare is resisting and overcoming and also defeating the enemy's lies. And so that tells me when you talk about spiritual warfare, it entails battling. It entails putting up a fight. And when you put up a fight, how many of you would agree with me? It's not something you do with levity. It's not something you do, you know, que sera, sera, what's gonna be is gonna be. But when you put up a fight, you put everything on your inside into it to ensure that you do not get damaged in the process of indulging in that fight. And that is exactly what we are looking at this morning, spiritual warfare. And our text is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I want to read from verse 3 through 5. It says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ." The Bible says that though we walk in the flesh, it says, but the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. And so when we hear this word, spiritual warfare, it tells me it's not something that can be done with a carnal mind. It's not something that can be done with an unstable mind. It's not something that can be done with an unbelieving mind. The Bible says that the weapons that we are to indulge in, they are spiritual weapons. They are not carnal weapons. And so this morning, you know, in my definition of what spiritual warfare is, you would have heard three main words that I want us to look at. And that is, those are the main weapons that the enemy uses against us as children of God. And those words are deception, accusation, and temptation. And so when we indulge in spiritual warfare, the devil most of the times comes in through these three channels. He wants to accuse you before your maker. That is exactly what he did in the case of Job. You know, I was telling us last week that when God presented Job before the devil, he said, "Have you seen my servant Job?" Devil came up and told him, he said, "It's because you have put a wall of protection around him." He said, "If you take away that wall of protection, you will be shocked at the way he will disappoint you." The devil has a way of taking the things that we have done and the things we have failed to do, you know, to use it to torment us. And so spiritual warfare all the time does not necessarily mean that there's a witch in your family or that there's a wizard in your family that is witch hunting you. Sometimes spiritual warfare has to do with our minds, with the thoughts that goes on in our minds, with the accusation that the devil brings our way. Something you may have done in the past, and anytime it's like you are beginning to take a step forward, the devil keeps bringing back that scenario to you. The devil keeps reminding you of the things that you did. It may even have been murder, and the devil still brings it back to your remembrance. But the Bible says that the weapon we should use, they are not the carnal one. It says casting down imagination and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God. How do you cast down imagination? How are you able to bring down every high thing that exalts itself above the knowledge of the Word of God? How do you do that? By countering it with the Word of God. And so I always tell people, there is little or nothing you can do as a child of God when you do not have the Word of God on your inside. When you do not know the Word of God for yourself, you cannot successfully indulge in spiritual warfare. Because when the devil brings those things to becloud your mind, you have nothing to put back to him. Just as our Lord Jesus Christ once said, he said, "The prince of this world cometh and he finds nothing in me." Because the devil specializes in using this weapon of accusation. He wants to remind you of the failures of the past. He wants to remind you of the things that you did in the past. You know, sometimes even as an individual, when the devil tries bringing certain things to your remembrance and you tell him, "I have been washed by the blood of the Lamb. I am a new creature. I am born again." He tells you, "But even after you got born again, you still did this, you did that, you did that." That is when you should be equipped with the Word of God and let him know that by grace we have been saved, not by works. And so the devil comes accusing us at all times. It's a very major weapon in the hand of the devil. And the only way you can counter him is when you are loaded with the Word of God to be able to give him back an answer for everything he brings up. Another weapon he uses is deception. We know the story of Adam and Eve from the very beginning. The Bible says that even when God created the man and the woman, the Bible says that everything God made was good, including Adam and Eve. And God gave them instructions as to what to do and what not to do, even in the garden. But we know that the devil came with his deceptive power and was able to kind of disorganize, you know, that arrangement that was made from the beginning. And today we have to toil, we have to go through all these struggles and pain that we go through because Adam and Eve yielded to the deception of the devil. But friends, I've come to tell you this morning, the Bible says in the book of Proverbs, it says, "My son, when sinners entice you, do not consent. When sinners entice you, do not give in. When the devil entices you, do not give in." Like Adam and Eve did, because many a times when you give in to the deception of the devil, all you get is a temporary, you know, comfort. Because the devil only shows you a part of the deal. He doesn't show you the whole deal. He doesn't tell you that when you fall for his deception today, that you are in for destruction tomorrow.
He only shows you the beautiful picture of what you will get, the immediate gain you stand to get. But he never shows you that when you do this, you get that. And so people of God have come to tell you today, if you want to successfully engage in a spiritual warfare, you should be able to overcome the deception of the devil, because it's a potent weapon that he uses. I don't know who you are. You're watching me this morning and you are struggling with a particular thing. The devil comes to dangle the carrot of life before you and all you do is jump at it. I tell you, you may get that comfort at that moment, but you stand to face pain tomorrow. And so, child of God, the Bible says that the only way that we can overcome the devil is to cast down this imagination, is to bring down everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. It's to be equipped with the word of God. It's to be filled with the word. The Bible says that the book of the law, that it shall not depart from you. You will meditate on it day and night. It is because God knows that every moment of your life, the devil is out to wage war. And you cannot fight back when you are empty. Another weapon that the devil uses is temptation. Yes, the word of God says we will not be allowed to be tempted with things that we are not able to overcome. But I tell you, the devil is a masterminder of temptation. He knows those areas where you are weak. Do not be deceived. He knows your weaknesses, and so he knows the area to tempt you in. Sometimes your area of weakness is different from mine. The strength you have is not the same thing as mine. Yours may be problem with women. You're a man watching me this morning, Holy Ghost filled tongue talking. You may have issues with women. The devil knows how to send your way those pretty ladies. Some of you may not have problem with women. It may be with money. He knows that even if he send 100 women your way, you will not budge. He will not bother sending women your way because he knows that that is not the target. But he will tempt you in the area of money where he knows that you have a weakness in. And so to be able to indulge in this spiritual warfare, you should be able to pad yourself, you know, with prayers and, you know, asking for the mercy of God at all times. So that you will be able to overcome the wiles of the enemy. The three major weapons we have looked at is deception, is accusation, and is temptation. The devil always wages war against us as children of God using these three major weapons. And so we want to look intensely, we want to look closely. What weapons should we use? He has his own weapons, and so we should also have our weapons. And besides, the Bible clearly says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. What are these weapons of our warfare? We have already mentioned that the word of God is paramount, that the word of God is important. The word of God is not an option. You cannot be a child of God and not know the word of God for yourself. One of the things that makes a lawyer, a good lawyer, stand out at any time is that he has a sound knowledge of what the laws of any society is where he's in. And he also has the facts and figures from his client. So when he stands to defend his client, he speaks with accuracy. The same way when you stand in the place of warfare, child of God, you must be equipped with the word of God to be able to pull down the works of the enemy. And so I sometimes jokingly tell people, I say, you know, the devil and demons do not understand the grammar. Many a time to want to stand in the place of spiritual warfare with all the I's dotted and all the T's crossed. I like that. It is very good. But if you do all that without having an in-depth knowledge of the word of God, you are just like a sounding cymbal with good constructed English language with no power. The Bible says that having the form of godliness but denying the power thereof. You cannot indulge in spiritual warfare when you do not have the word of God deeply rooted in you. Another weapon we want to look at this morning is the name of Jesus. I have never seen any man who indulged in spiritual warfare and came out triumphant without indulging the name of Jesus. The Bible says that the name has been given unto us. It says, I'm paraphrasing, it says that on this earth and in heaven, the name has been given that at the name of Jesus, at the mentioning of that name, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. So it doesn't matter how the enemy tries. It doesn't matter through whatever angle it comes in. When you have that name, then you are sure to have victory. But let me quickly say, you must know the owner of the name. Hallelujah. You must know the person who owns the name for the name to be effective. You cannot just come and say, in the name of Jesus that my pastor preaches, in the name of Jesus that mommy and daddy says. You must know Jesus for yourself, or else you will end up like the seven sons of Sceva. The Bible says that the seven sons of Sceva, they were playing the fool. And they came before demons. And they say, in the name of Jesus that Paul preaches, get out. Oh, friends, go and look at the story. The Bible says they got the beating of their life because the demons posted it at them. It said, Paul, I know. It said, Jesus, I know. Who are you? To use the name of Jesus, you must know who Jesus is. You must be qualified to use that name. There must be a relationship between you and the owner of the name. You are not to use the name illegally when indulging in spiritual warfare. How do you use it illegally when you do not have connection with it? Hallelujah. So the name of Jesus is a potent weapon in indulging in spiritual warfare. You cannot conquer except you use the name of Jesus. That is the only name that every other name bows to. Another potent weapon, we want to look at the book of Revelation. Hallelujah. Let's see what the Bible says in Revelation this morning. We are looking at Revelation 12:11. It says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not themselves or their lives unto the death. It says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. The blood of Jesus is a potent weapon. And so you are indulging in spiritual warfare. It's not just throwing your arrows in any direction. It's throwing the arrows with precision. And the one way you could do that is through the blood of Jesus. The Bible says that the blood of Jesus speaks better things than that of Abel. The blood of Jesus speaks better things than that of condemnation. And so this morning, you want to indulge the power in the blood of Jesus. In the blood of Jesus lies the power to overcome. That is why the Bible says they overcame by the blood of the Lamb. And so this morning, you are going through things. You are going through situations. You have prayed, you have toiled, you have studied. Apply the blood of Jesus. Use that potent weapon. Call the blood of Jesus. Friends, I can tell you it works. When you use it by faith, it works. When you use it like you know it, it works. I can tell you that. If not, the Bible would not have told us that there's an overcoming when the blood of Jesus is called into action. And so this morning you may be going through a form of oppression, all kind of things going on in your family. I don't know what situation you may be in. You wake up in the morning with all kind of marks on your body. You sleep at night with all kind of things coming to oppress you in your sleep. The blood of Jesus is a potent weapon. The Bible says that the weapon that we indulge in is not, they are not carnal. The blood of Jesus is a potent weapon. And I want to let you know that to be able to indulge in this spiritual warfare we are talking about, you have to be bold. No lily-livered man can indulge in spiritual warfare. Because friends, let me remind you that the devil does not give up. He only lives for a season. The Bible says he's always going to and fro, looking for who to devour. He never gives up. And so you have to be bold in what you do. You have to be persistent in what you do. Because most at times, the spiritual warfare that we go through, they are not once and for all thing. You don't fight it once and for all. It keeps coming over and over and over again. And so I don't know what area you may be fighting this morning. I don't know what area you may be indulging in that warfare. It could be in your family life. It could be in the life of your children. It could be in your job. It could be in your finances. It could be in your ministry. It could be anywhere. I've come to admonish you. You cannot give up. Pick up your weapons and be ready to wage war. Using the name of Jesus, using the blood, standing in boldness. Because the Bible says that the righteous are as bold as a lion. No timid person can indulge in spiritual warfare. That is why the prophet of old, when he was going to select the people that were going to battle with him, he selected the bold ones. And so this morning you are watching me. You are in that category of people who are saying, you don't understand, sister. I can't take this anymore. I have been in this for years. Nothing seemed to be changing. You have what we call the almost there syndrome. Anytime you are almost at the verge of breakthrough, it's like something comes and the whole thing crumbles. I said, sister, you do not understand the battle that I'm in. I'm in a battle of life that seems unconquerable. I have come to tell you, brother. I've come to tell you, sister, hold on using your weapons. If you faint not, victory is at the corner. If you do not give up, victory is at the corner. And the last point I want to emphasize on this morning, you cannot indulge in spiritual warfare when you do not have a sound prayer life. Are you listening to me, people of God? You have to be up and doing in your prayer life. You have to be fervent in your prayer life. You have to be consistent with your prayer life. Or else the devil will sift you as wheat. And so this morning you are going through those trying times. Like you are saying, sister, you don't understand. I have been in this. It is so difficult. It is so hard. Let me remind you what the Bible says in James 5:16b thereabout. I'm paraphrasing. It says the effective and the effectual prayers of the righteous makes tremendous power available. The only way you can conquer is not to give up. The only way you can have that breakthrough is to keep hitting. Just keep going. Just keep going. Keep going. You have been applying for that job. Every time you go, they turn you down. Keep going. You have been applying for that visa. Every time you go, they turn you down. Keep going. Keep fighting. And someday, you will come out triumphant. And so you are listening to me this morning. You do not know Jesus. You don't even know who we are talking about. You don't even have a relationship with him. Oh, like I love to say, you are like an open field for the enemy. With an open field with no fence, with no gate. Like a city without walls. The enemy can come in at any time and do whatever he likes in your life. And so you're watching me, you don't know Jesus. This is an opportunity. The Bible says that when you receive him, when you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and you believe in your heart that God raised him up from the dead, he said, you shall be saved. And so you're watching me this morning. You do not know Jesus, but you want to say, sister, I am tired of the life I live. I want to be able to indulge in spiritual warfare that I will come out triumphant. The first step is to accept Jesus into your life. Because remember, I told you at the beginning, you cannot use the name when you do not know the owner of the name. This is an opportunity for you to accept the owner of that name. And so you are watching me. You want to lift up your right hand and say after me, dear Lord Jesus, I come to you today as a sinner. I believe that you came to die on the cross. I believe that you were raised from the dead. I accept you into my life as my Lord and personal Savior. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Hallelujah. If you just said those prayers, I want you to be rejoicing because the whole of heaven is doing the same thing. And so this morning you are watching me and you are in a situation where you don't see it, like you are in a maze. You don't see a way out. I have come to proclaim today that the Lord is going to make all those bars to fall apart and you will begin to make a headway. I hold bound their kings, the ones that are disturbing you. I hold bound their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron. I join my faith with yours this morning and I declare that you are set free. I declare that you are victorious. I declare that you are on top and not beneath. Everything you lay your hands upon, even as you go out from this morning, shall prosper and be blessed. And until I come your way next week, I want you to walk out in boldness. I know that the creator of the universe is on your side, and above all, that you are a champion. And you are born to rule and reign in life.
He can move mountains. Keep me in the valley. Hide me from the rain. Come on, I got it.